We are built for this network for the strong, not the weak.
Greetings, brothers and sisters, family and friends. I am your minister of wellness, Nathaniel Jordan. Prevent and reverse all disease 100% naturally. This is part 92. That's right, part 92. And in this video, we're going to discuss food allergies, not seasonal allergies. I've covered that already. Look in the playlist. Prevent and reverse all disease for the disease related to what you are going through now. This is food allergies. Before I dive into this information, tomorrow, brothers and sisters, free Black History event at Jubilee Community Church, 4231 North Grand, 4231 North Grand. I will be delivering a powerful message you don't want to miss. The standard American diet, make no mistake about it, is the greatest weapon of mass destruction Black people are facing because it is an addictive weapon of destruction. I'll be there. I'll have my table with all of my products. It's 100% free. If you're in St. Louis in the area, or you know someone in St. Louis, please share this information. Then remember, I hit the road March 1st, Herndon, Virginia, Life Ticket Church, Herndon, Virginia. Come on out for the Sunday morning service to hear me deliver the biblical health message. Then March 7th, Shelby, North Carolina. Shelby, North Carolina is hosting its first ever 100% plant-based health fair. And I, your minister of wellness, will be the keynote speaker. Check the description box for all registration information on these events and for the many other events that I have coming up. Check the description box and the pinned comment section of this video. Food allergies occur when the immune system produces IgE antibodies against specific foods, causing allergic reactions that range from a mild rash to anaphylaxis and death. Reactions occur minutes to hours after breathing, touching, or eating the allergenic food. Signs and symptoms can involve the skin, respiratory, gastrointestinal, and cardiovascular systems. Food sensitivities differ from food allergies. Here's the difference. The body produces IgG or IgA antibodies against specific foods, which manifest as subacute or chronic symptoms that generally affect the skin or gastrointestinal tract. So almost similar to an autoimmune disease, food allergies. Food intolerances are not mediated by the immune system, okay, and can occur due to chemicals found in the food and inability to absorb nutrients or lack of certain enzymes to digest the food. So again, food allergies are very closely related to autoimmune disease. Food allergies are more prevalent in children and adults, but there is an increasing rate of new onset allergies in adults. Childhood food allergies tend to wane or resolve over the years, but it can persist into adulthood. As a matter of fact, from 1997 to 2007, the prevalence of food allergies increased 18% for children under the age of 18, with 3 million children reporting some type of allergy. Eight foods accounted for 90% of food allergies. Here they are: milk, eggs, peanuts, tree nuts, fish, shellfish, soy, and wheat. Symptoms vary among each person. Mild symptoms of food allergies include hives or rashes, itchy, watery, swollen eyes, runny nose or sneezing, and headaches. Severe symptoms that are known as Anaphylaxis include swelling of the throat, shortness of breath, cough, wheezing, dizziness, low blood pressure, syncope, vomiting, diarrhea, death. The main contributor to food allergies is a poor diet that results in increased intestinal permeability. The development and production of the immune-protecting interstitial lymphocytes is dependent on phytonutrients in green vegetables and other natural plant foods. Without exposure to colorful compounds, particularly greens, during pregnancy and in the mother's diet during breastfeeding, as well as in early life, decreased digestive tract immunity and integrity is likely. The protective barrier that stops foreigners and toxins from throwing the immune system of the gut out of whack is weakened and compromised when we are not giving the immune system the strength it needs to keep that barrier strong through a micronutrient dense diet. That's what I've just said, brothers and sisters. With increased intestinal permeability, consumed protein fragments called peptides are absorbed and recognized as foreign by the immune system. So the wall is breached. Okay? The immune system is the military. The wall gets breached. And the immune system recognizes these fragments of peptides as foreign. This results in antibody formation against that specific food. So now every time the food is consumed in the future, more antibodies are produced, manifesting in various symptoms. Consumption of a low nutrient, high inflammatory diet damages the gut lining even further and increases the risk of food allergies. Lack of exclusive breastfeeding until the age of 6 months at least should be 2 years. That increases the risk of food allergies. Breastfeeding decreases intestinal permeability and colonizes the infant's gut with beneficial immune regulating probiotics. Medications that decrease stomach acid production also increase the risk of developing food allergies, as these prevent the complete digestion of proteins, leaving behind an intact form that is more allergenic. Vitamin D and omega-3 fatty acid deficiencies also affect the immune system and may contribute to food allergies. There's a protective wall that lines our gut. And this junk food diet, it invades that wall, and the immune system protects itself by developing a weapon attack against specific peptides in that poison you're consuming. So now, even when you're eating something healthy, if it even looks like it's the toxin that the antibody was designed to attack, now you can't even eat a whole natural plant food. That's food allergies in the Make It Plain Minister of Wellness version. What's the action plan? Can this be reversed? Well, the nutritarian diet is anti-inflammatory and has an array of antioxidants and other phytochemicals that can reduce the incidence of food allergies and aid in the restoration of interstitial lymphocyte clusters in the villi of the small intestines. So it can rebuild the great wall that defends our gut from an overload of waste buildup, of toxic invasion. Strict avoidance of allergenic foods is recommended, especially when severe symptoms are experienced. After a few years of a strict nutritarian diet that aids in increasing tolerance to foods and healing of intestinal permeability, slow reintroduction of minute portions of allergenic foods such as oral tolerance therapy. That's what that's called. Under the supervision of your holistic physician may be attempted. When more mild symptoms are experienced, these foods can be reintroduced at earlier intervals. An elimination diet is a useful diagnostic tool to evaluate food allergies and sensitivities. The most allergenic foods such as dairy, eggs, peanuts, tree nuts, fish, soy, wheat, and any other foods suspected of causing symptoms are eliminated for 3 to 4 weeks. Then if symptoms improve, individual foods are cautiously introduced back into the diet over 2 to 3 days. Any foods that cause recurring symptoms need to be avoided. Have your holistic physician check your vitamin D levels. Supplement to achieve a level of 25 to 40 nanograms per milliliter. Supplementing with omega-3 fatty acids and borage oil in addition to a nutritarian diet can improve food allergies and sensitivities. Again, the DHA, EPA supplement, and then borage oil as shown in the photo here. These can improve food allergies and sensitivities. Micronutrient adequacy, that's the second component of eating to live. Breastfeeding is so important, sisters, future moms, current moms. Exclusive breastfeeding in the first 6 months of life is the ideal way to feed infants. As the digestive tract matures during the first year of life, it's very important. The spaces between the cells that allow the mother's immunoglobulins to be absorbed gradually get tighter, reducing the potential for food allergies. So breastfeeding should continue, if possible, until age 2. After 6 months, one new food should be introduced every 2 days so parents can watch for signs of food allergies or sensitivities. Introducing a variety of foods, including nuts and seeds, while still being fed breast milk with the mother consuming the same foods offers the best protection against allergies. Remember, I have a supplement for pregnant women, a multivitamin, multimineral. I have the DHA, EPA. I have a supplement, multivitamin, multimineral for children, and they can also take the DHA, EPA. The gut health supplement, the probiotic supplement, is in stock, along with the immunity boosting supplement. The Minister of Wellness.com, the Minister of Wellness.com. And also remember, while you're on my online store, to grab the Eat for Health book or Prevent and Reverse All Disease 100% Naturally. All of the books, even outside of those books, I have all of my books have exact meal plans and delicious recipes to follow. Food allergies can be reversed. If you have trouble with placing an order through my online store, which is again the ministerofwellness.com, make sure you call 888-847-8026, 888-847-8026, and we can assist you with placing an order. If you would like to be a support to Ministry of Wellness, Inc. outside of purchasing something on my website, my Cash App is $MinisterofWellness, $MinisterofWellness. However, in the description box and pinned comment section, I have many other ways you can make a donation. I'm still waiting for the first person to donate towards the official PayPal fundraiser page that I have. And your donations are used to promote this truth to reach a much wider audience so they can be blessed with the information that is being a blessing to your life. I sincerely thank you all for your love, prayers, and support. Again, make sure you check the description box and pinned comment section for all of my upcoming events. You can also follow me on Facebook to keep up with all of my events. And also, I post free recipes Monday through Friday. I'm on Instagram, Twitter, and LinkedIn. You can find me on all of those other platforms at The Minister of Wellness to make sure that you don't miss any new information, announcements, and events that I have coming up. Definitely join my Facebook group. I can be healthy. I will be healthy. I must be healthy, where we come together to motivate each other to get off the death train. That's I can be healthy. I will be healthy. I must be healthy Facebook group. If you would like for me to come and speak life to your city or country, please share my website with organizations and other people in your area that can book me to speak. I work with all budget levels. Churches are a great place to start with sharing my website with the pastor, because it would be their decision. And usually churches, depending on the size, they have a budget set aside for bringing speakers in. However, you have colleges, universities, and numerous other events that are going on. And you never know, if you share with the event organizer my information, they may look at it and be willing to allocate some funds to bring me in to speak. That's the ministerofwellness.com, or they can call 888-847-8026. Be persistent and be patient, brothers and sisters, with sharing my information. And trust me, I will be speaking life to a city or country near you. I hope and pray you all live a long life in excellent health. It can and it will be yours.
Thank you. Once again, it's on. This is Built for This Network. I'm H-Rap B. And I'm coming at you live and direct with this new program I've developed called Build and Destroy. If you're unaware of the program, the content of the program, it is to build up our community and destroy the myths that are around our community. We are not inherently disruptive. We are not inherently violent. We are not chaotic. We are none of the things that you see on television that has been propagated through your community. Brothers don't do this, sisters don't do that. We are none of those things. So what I am going to do week by week, day by day, month by month, is bring you information to help build up our community, so people that look like you can stop saying those things, and people who look like you can stop believing that prophecy. I want to thank the Minister of Wellness. He's another guy that I've connected with on the internet, and basically, his job is to, basically what he does is provide information about health and wellness. And I share that information with you. And what I'm going to do is continue to put that at the top of each one of my shows, in hopes that it will inspire you and put you in a better situation, health-wise, mental health, physical health, spiritually healthy, and you'll be a better person because of it. And again, thank you for tuning in. If you've clicked the link, no matter how you got the link, you're listening currently. If you have created a profile and moved into the chat room, I want you to hit the like button and, if possible, share. Tell a friend to tune in so we can continue the growth of our community. And if you haven't, please do so. Hit the like button, share. And again, thank you, each and every one of you in the chat room. I'd like to thank each and every one of you who are listening. This is H-Rap B. And you know how I begin each and every one of my shows. It was taught to me that if you show homage and respect to your ancestors that have crossed over to the other side, they'll send down blessings and protections to anybody who's listening to you. Now, therefore, I send respect to everyone in my family that's connected to the Pollocks, the Turners, the Battles, the Cottons, the Harpers, the Baileys, the Crisp, the Lansdowns, the Lansdowns, the Liggins, the Duncans, and anybody who knows me, you know me, my moms and my pops, my sisters and my brothers out of Williams Clan. Now, as I said, man, what I'm going to do today is continue to build up our community one week at a time. It's going to take a lot of work. It's going to take a ton of work. And then once we get this work propagated, we'll continue to build our communities. Now, one of the things that's on my mind is, of course, this whole corona situation. This is a deadly virus that's attacking our community at an alarming rate. And as I said on our Wednesday show, one of the reasons that it is, whether you believe it or not, whether you believe this is 5G or any other theories that are floating around in the community, first of all, I want to attack that. Let me take a step back and attack that. People who get upset when you have a theory about what's going on in the United States of America that does not align with mainstream media, you really need, as the MC, Super MC, Super Dope Brother from Drink Champ says, you need to relax. Because as a person from our community, living in the United States of America, you have no reason to trust anything that comes out of your TV or your radio if you haven't researched it. You have zero reason to trust it. So if you are listening to the news and one of your friends or family members says, hey, this could be it. It could be, it well could be that. I'm not saying believe everything that you hear, but stop dismissing people who have an alternative way of thinking because, hey, at the end of the day, like they say, even paranoid people are enemies. So, and being a part of this community, looking back from 1913 to 1972, the Tuskegee experiment was also something that nobody believed up until and included the moment they told everybody, oh yeah, we use black people as guinea pigs in Tuskegee, Alabama, just so happened to be what my father's family was. Half the people on that list I just read off are from Tuskegee or have roots from Tuskegee, Alabama. So trust and believe, things are real. So I'm not asking anybody to believe any theory that people call conspiracy theories, but stop dismissing everything that you hear just because somebody with pale skin did not put a stamp on it and say it was okay. Back to the show. But whether you believe things or not, this thing is, the reason we are under attack is the very reason I put that brother at the top of my show called the Minister of Wellness. The food that we are ingesting are weakening our immune systems. The stress that we take on from work, life, the violence, the inherent violence, the proposed inherent violence that is in our community, struggling every day, this weakens us. And this is why Corona and other autoimmune and diseases and illnesses attack our community. It's not because we are weaker or anything of that nature. It is because you're not taking care of yourself. You are arguing, you are stressing, you are upset. And that stress, that intense way of living is destroying you from the inside out. And when you allow these things to do you, anything that comes along will destroy your body and destroy your mind and destroy your well-being. So that's the first request I have. Take 5 or 10 minutes out your day every day. Really take an hour out your day every day and walk down the stress. Now, the next thing I want to talk about is a lot of people are up in arms about things like, hey man, you know, people, I've had conversations with people. I didn't give them any pushback, but I was listening to them say, I hope they come out with a vaccination for this. I hope they come out with something to stop this. This is a virus. A virus is a mutating organism that always changes. It is ever changing. If it's always ever changing, there's no vaccination that can really get rid of it. It can't be eradicated. It can just be, you could develop antibodies that make your body stronger to fight things off at a more rapid pace. So stop looking for people who don't have your best interest in mind to give you something, to take care of something. Because as we've seen, we're looking at something that is destroying your body from the inside out. You don't need a pill to fight a virus. You don't need a shot to fight a virus. What you need to do is take care of yourself. As I stated on the Wednesday show again, I'm not asking anyone to stop eating anything. What I am going to do, like the Minister of Wellness wants you to stop eating meat altogether. If it walks, crawls, has a mom or pops, he does not want you to eat it. I'm not going to go that far to ask you that. What I want you to do is add vegetation to your diet. Make it a more balanced diet. Stop reminiscing to when your grandparents were, when you were younger, my grandparents ate meat. Because your grandparents grew up in an era without refrigeration, so they didn't eat meat the way we consume, for one. For two, the meat that they were eating wasn't contaminated, because more than likely that meat came from a hog or a cow or what have you, or a chicken or what have you, that they raised. So when you raise something, you develop something, you put the love and TLC into it, there is no antibiotics, there are no radiation, there's no radiation, no pesticides added to this animal or what have you to destroy you. Remember, since people like to reflect back to their grandparents, guess what else your grandparents used to have? Most of our grandparents come from the South, or are even still in the South, and they have what is called a garden. They can mail you. My aunt Arvis used to do that. She used to preserve things, put them in jars, and send them to everybody in Chicago. When she lived in South Illinois, she didn't live in what is called traditional South or the Deep South. So since you want to reference your grandparents all the time, if you have a yard next to your house, won't you take some of those seeds from your bell peppers or what have you and make your garden outside your house? That way you will have sweet potatoes. You will have bell peppers, onions, and things like that. You could grow those things and preserve them in your own house and use them all winter instead of always breaking to the store and breaking bad, breaking food. So what we have to do is, since everybody is all gung-ho on doing what my grandparents did and this used to work, well, won't you live like your grandparents? Talk to some of your aunts and your uncles and find out what your grandparents used to do, and then adapt some of those characteristics instead of just talking about them. Now, as I move on, I want to talk about this whole situation with the President of the United States. This is where I really want to focus today. The President of the United States is on TV daily, scaring the hell out of people. He's destroying hope, adding stress to your life. He's speaking out of the side of his neck, destroying faith in a system that maybe you shouldn't even have anyway. But a lot of us do have faith in the system. And I'm not here to judge you if you have faith in the system. If you have faith in the system, God bless you. Live the best life you can live possible. Thank you. But what I do want to do is talk about civics. And in civics, what happens in civics is, I believe, this is, again, this is all these are my opinions. I believe that we don't practice enough civics in our community. And what do I mean by that is this. Our kids traditionally don't know how the government works. And what me and all the stronger brothers in the United States of America, what we really need to do is this. We need to get together and start practicing civics. What I want us to do is this. I want us to create communities in which we can hold these people who we put in office responsible for what they're doing. And how we do that is this. Come up with a plan. You need to come up with a plan for every elected official in your community. You need to have a committeeman, a city councilman, an alderman, a state representative, a state senator, a U.S. senator, your governor, and the mayor of your city. They need to be in your crossfires in regards to everything you need. The reason I want us to do this is this. A lot of people complain, man, Barack Obama didn't do enough for us. Barack Obama was on BS. Barack Obama didn't do this. Barack Obama didn't do that. Well, what did you do for Barack Obama? What was your plan for Barack Obama? And then now we go, oh man, Trump, he ain't gonna do this and he ain't gonna do that. Okay, what is your plan for Donald Trump? See, we can't make complaints unless we have a game plan, and then they disappoint us. And then we bust our ass to get them out of office. I'm a person who really, I didn't really participate into the voting thing. Because, again, I didn't believe in it. And it was real easy for me to sit on the sideline and say, this ain't going to happen. That ain't going to happen. But unless you have a game plan, you don't know what the hell's going to happen. All you're doing is talking loud and not saying anything at that point. So, by practice civics, what we'll do is, just like your kids see you drink and they drink. You see, they see you smoke, they smoke. They see you smoking weed, they smoke weed. They see people in the community sell drugs, they sell drugs. What we need to do is this. Have our communities, get in contact with everybody on your block. People on both sides of the street. And as you get in contact with people on both sides of the street, what you do is have like a block club and get a block club president and have people in charge of this block club. And the reason you do that is this. You don't realize it, but you see, it looks like a party or an event or a gathering. But the men and the women who care about your community can sit down and meet and lay out simple projects for the people who you've elected to do. Something simple like, you know, you have a lot of communities with a lot of trash floating around. One of the reasons they have a lot of trash floating around is because there are no trash receptacles at the end of each corner. A lot of communities are like that. I'm all over the city of Chicago. And in the poor neighborhoods, there are no trash receptacles. And in the richer neighborhoods, they are. So, something as simple as that. We all want better school for our children. We all want after school programs for our children. We all want better paved streets. These are the things that you have to address. Lights, street lights. So the women who are getting on, these single mothers who are getting off work, they don't have to walk down the street and look over their shoulders every 2 or 3 seconds. See, these are the things that we need to address immediately that you can have an instant effect on as an individual in your community. And then and only then can you hold these politicians' feet to the fire. Because you just can't stand around and say, well, it's come time to end this concept of stand around and saying what they're not going to do for us. Before I finish, allow me to address the naysayers. You will have a ton of people say what will and what will not work because if they are not presenting you with an alternative idea so it will work, use those people as motivation. I'm going to say that again. If they are not presenting you with the ability to fix what they perceive as a problem, use those people as motivation, because I've never met a naysayer with a plan. I have never met a naysayer with a plan. Oh, that's not going to work, rap. I don't even address those people anymore. Because, see, if you're not a naysayer, what you will say, hey, rap, that's not going to work. It worked this way in this instance. If you just stop right there at rap, this is not going to work. What you're doing is telling me that you've never tried anything and you would rather see me fail and be miserable just like you than to help me move this thing forward. And those people, we have to just do away with it. Oh, man, it's not going to work rap. That's not going to work rap. Or it's not going to work jungle. That's not going to work jungle. Look. What we're going to do is eliminate those people. All right? And when you eliminate them, you'll find yourself being in a better situation spiritually and mentally. So, as we're creating this, the problems that exist in our communities are lack of support, governmental support, poor academics, no after-school programs, and crime infestation. First of all, when you get to know this block club that I'm trying to get people, or this civics exercise that I want to get people involved in, this is so you don't have to be worried about the dudes that's standing outside pushing dope on your block. I was looking at Facebook yesterday, and my homegirl Wanda was just simply looking out her window, looking at her community, and she saw a man gun down a man with a Tech 9 yesterday. in the middle of a pandemic, when people are not even supposed to be outside, this person walked up to another person's car and opened up a Tech Nine. A couple of weeks ago, just north of my blocks, not even two blocks away from my house, on my old block, as a matter of fact, another young man was murdered. We have to get out of this comfort zone of letting people stand around our communities. This is why our children are shut-ins. This is why our children are getting fat and lazy. This is why our children have zero motivation. Because when you're stuck inside of four walls, all you can do is look at this madness that they're pushing through our television, listen to this madness that they're pushing through our ears via the radio, and then you expect your child to grow and develop and be a well-rounded individual. That's impossible. But if K3000, thank you for being in the chat room, like in Chicago, I'm going to use K3000, I'm going to use Jungle Brother, I'm going to use D-Grade as examples. In Chicago, our communities are set up by 100 blocks. I live in the 2300 block. So it's 20, on one side of the street is 2300. On the other side of the street is 2301, and it goes to like 2350 right before you get to 2400. So if K3000 lives on the 2200 block, and I live on the 2300 block, the Jungle Brother lives on the 2400 block, and D-Grade lives on the 2500 block, what they need to do is create a pocket for things that they want on just on that block. And then me, K3000, Jungle Brother, and D-Grade meet up and have a conversation. We don't even have to meet up. Technology allows us to just use our phones and talk to each other through the phone, and make sure our communities are safe. So if K3000 sees the guy, he's on the way home, and he looks into the 2300 block and see a bunch of dudes milling around, and he does not recognize those young men, he needs to be on the phone with Jungle Brother, me, and D-Grade and say, who is that? And if we don't know, those people are attempting to disrupt our peace, and we need to get those dudes the fuck off our blocks. And yes, I said it, the fuck off our blocks. We got to stop looking at these people who are destroying our peace, who are attacking our children as brothers, because they are not. Either you part of the solution or you are the problem. And since they're the problem, guess what? You put the enemy of your enemy is your friend. The police is the enemy in a lot of cases. So I don't want to hear about what, not all police. Hey man, if you are part of an organization that's destroying my community, you are my enemy. And if you're not speaking up, you part of the problem. You are the problem. So, the dudes that's standing outside our communities, shooting at our, making it unsafe for our children, making it unsafe for our women, we need to stick those wild dogs and those blue cars on their asses. Another thing, K3000, Jungle Brother, myself, and D-Grade, we need to know every desk sergeant in the precinct that we live in. We need to know every captain in the precinct we live in. So in the event that our children, our women, our sisters, brothers, aunts, uncles, grandparents get harassed by a police officer, he needs to be the answer to us. That's the only way this thing is going to work. There is nobody that's going to come save us. This fictitious politician that's going, who got the new 2020 lie, ain't gonna help us unless we put a gun to his head metaphorically and make him do it. See, because K3000, D-Grade, myself, and Jungle, we got 50 families on, and we got 25 to 50 families in each one, in each 100 block of our community. And then guess what? We gonna know the people, 30, like I live 100 south. We gonna know people on the 200, 300, and 400 south, and the 100, 200, 300 north. And we can do that. And we can get these people in order and get them the hell up out of our communities. It's chaos. We're not going to eradicate crime, but we can make our community safe. We can create a force field to make it so your kids can be at the park. We can do that, y'all. I mean, this is not difficult. Everybody always say, everybody always say, it ain't going to happen. It can't happen. It's gonna take work. That's what it's gonna take. It's gonna take work. And if you tired of your grandkids having the inability to play like you used to, if you tired of your kids reading out of books with your damn name in it, you remember back in the day, you used to have to sign your name in the book. If your kid got a book with your name in it, everybody in the school board need the hell slapped out of them. Another thing, school board presidents, judges. I got something to talk about with the judges a little later. We need to get hold of our environment. And when we do that, we'll be fine. Stop with the kumbaya too, y'all. We don't have to like each other to work together. We do not have the ability to not, I cannot be like, I'm not messing with Jungle Brother. I'm not messing with K3000. I ain't got to hang out with K3. I ain't got to hang out with Jungle Brother. I ain't got to hang out with D-Great to make sure they kids safe. Because you know what? Whatever issue that us three have amongst each other, it has nothing to do with our children. So this old, I don't really like him because he a Muslim. I don't really like him because he a Christian, a Catholic, a Jehovah's Witness. So fucking what? Don't worry about what they're doing in their personal business. If you have the same mission with this person, which is to make your community, wherever you live, as safe as possible, that's all you need. We're not asking people to have kids by each other, to have drinks with each other. I am asking you to put yourself in a situation so Jungle Brother's daughter could date my son and not get shot. Jungle Brother's grandson can play with my granddaughter and not get shot. Ben can bring his niece and nephew to play with me and Jungle Brother's grandchildren and they not get hurt. Damn the personal affiliations, okay? Unless, there is an exception, unless one of your affiliations is part of the problem. I'm going to say it again, unless one of your affiliations is one of the problems. If you signed up to be a person who's supporting a dumbass like your president, then I won't be bothered with you because we can clearly see that this dude has no intentions to help us. But again, like I said at the top of the conversation, we must put ourselves in a position to in which we can make that dude tell us no. Like if you are living in a quote unquote red state, blue state, whatever, make that red. If you are a staunch Democrat and that you believe in a democratic system, make that damn there do what you need them to do. What good did it do to vote and then sit back and wait? That shit is retarded. Oh, well, see, he wasn't going to do. Now, I get the fact. The homeboy at 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue is not have our best interest. But instead of getting mad at the Steve Harveys and them dudes at the HBCUs and all that for photo ops, we should have had somebody in that room too representing us. Say, hey, well, what you gonna? I know you gonna do that for them. What about me? What about me? I represent the 2300 block of Monroe. K3000 represents the 2200 block. D Great represents 25 and Jungle represents 24. What was you gonna do for our community? That's what we need to be. And until we get there, all this complaining, you might as well just be saying that to yourself. Because it's not gonna get you anywhere. Again, we don't have to like anybody who's elected. And I don't give a damn. Because look, the only way you can get this fixed is to call them out when they are in office and say, hey, tell you what, we're going to keep organizing until we get your ass out of here. When you start threatening people's position, they pay attention. Oh, cats won't try to meet the public outcry. To hell, if they get annoyed, to hell with them. If you're not down, we're skipping over you. And once you say you're not down, or once you bring that negative energy to us, Big Illinois, what we're doing is leaving you right where you stand, and we're not looking back. There ain't no later date applications, because we have a movement of righteousness. So if you wasn't righteous at the word go, you don't become righteous. What you do is realize it's beneficial to you, and we don't need your ass then. Now, we're not going to ostracize you, but you can never be part of our coalition or consortium or group or whatever you want to call it. You can't be a part of this if you're not down at hello. Hello, this is what we're about. This is what we're trying to get done. This is our plan of action. Let's go. If you go, that's the person that will sell your ass out to the people on the other side of your battle. The dude. You complained about criminal justice reform, but we're disorganized. We live in cities where we are 500,000-600,000 strong, and we don't even know the judges. We don't know the state's attorneys. We don't know the prosecutors. We don't know anything, and we need. And if we are populating the vast majority of the prison system, we need to know that and those people. We really do, y'all. We have to know those people, because when you know those people, you have a fighting chance. Again, it's easy to complain to Joe from Houston, sitting in Chicago, Illinois, about something that's happening in Los Angeles. But we got a friend in Los Angeles, the greatest. And I'm assuming K3000 from Philadelphia, and Chief Rock is from Georgia, and Sabrina's from Indiana. She can get all her people, you can get all your people, and we can start, hey, we can't go out and protest now. But we can start an email campaign to our state senators. Like, hey, this is how many people, I got 1,000 people behind me, and they know 1,000 people. If this bullshit happens where I live, you will be one of the unemployment statistics, because you will not have that job. And we need to have a 6-month plan for what they need to be giving us every 6 months up until we are satisfied, because we ain't never going to be happy. I don't give a damn. It's never going to be enough, because it ain't enough for other people, so it ain't going to be enough for me. So if you tired of housing being terrible, you're tired of academic programs being lacking, if you're tired of the absence of after-school programs, you have to organize. The great Kwame Ture, you may know him as Stokely Carmichael, he references Dr. King and George Washington. If you put his statement, if you put George Washington in the middle of Valley Forge by himself, and you put the great Dr. Martin Luther King in Selma, Alabama by himself, the police and the British will beat them to death and kill them. But once they organize, once they immobilize, which was Dr. King was great at, and then they organize a Montgomery boycott, and they organize the revolution, they have the ability to defeat what was known as the greatest army in the history of the world at that time, and they have an opportunity to hold at bay one of the most racist Jim Crow systems in the history of the earth. And if you don't think it's the history of the earth, Adolf Hitler, in his book Mein Kampf, says he used American discrimination tactics to create his wall that he created against the Jews. So, understand that. Understand that. So, if you are worried about income disparity, it's because, and lack of employment opportunities, it's because you and the people in your community have not organized and take advantage of things like tax increment financing. I'm going to say it again. Tax increment financing. This is financing that is provided by your elected officials in your community. In your community, that is free. F-R-E-E. Do you know that your alderman and state representatives, part of their elected job is to give? I'm going to type it in the chat room. Give you money. Everybody knows a studious person. Everybody knows a person who can organize. He's an immobilizer. You know people who immobilize, a.k.a. Dr. King. He can get a bunch of people in the room together and get things cracking. Who's an organizer, a.k.a. the great Malcolm X? He created organization. And once you get those people together in the same room, you'll get some of the things that you want. So you know somebody who's studious, they can write out things. You know, they on Facebook policing everything you said. It's not ain't. It's not. It's not fin to. It's about to. We all know that dude or that woman. So use that jackass to help you write a business proposal so you can take it to your local state representative, your local state senator, your local alderman, so he can get you the funding to open up your corner store. Use that. Because if you not, what the hell you complaining about? Because guess what? Most of us, I can't say everybody, most of us have a cousin, friend, uncle, a niece, nephew, or what have you, who has a background. But if you own a corner store, you can get that person a job. Guess what? Black unemployment just went down because you gave your cousin no background check needed. You trying to get your life together? Cool, man. Work in my store. And then you could open up 10, 11 stores like people from those OPEC companies, countries. That's what you can do. And it won't cost you anything. Hey, people who own corner stores, their kids, back in my day, their kids used to be the slickest dressed. They were the first kids with cars because everybody buying Doritos and Cheetos and 99 cent liter pops and all this and all that. They making $5,000-$6,000 a day off lottery Cheetos and ice cream and soda. So if you don't think that's a lucrative industry, why the hell do everybody keep popping them up in our community? You sitting around, I mean, I taste my five hamburgers. Taste like, I'm going to call him out. My homeboy, Kirby, he listening. I know he listening because every day, at the end of every show, he calls me and say how much he liked the show and bullet point what he liked on the show. So Kirby motherfucking ass, he makes this awesome homemade from scratch salad dressing. I say, Kirby, man, you need to put that in some bottles and sell it. Yeah, bro, I'm going to do that. Guess how long he been saying that? He been saying that as long as I've been doing this for 4 years. But guess what? Kirby was the inspiration for me to start the other show that I do, The End of the Bench. He said, man, you need to be on the radio with the stuff you say. And I did it. So, Kirby, I'm calling you out, brother. And it's a bunch of people that you know, oh, man, I make this bomb salad dressing. I make this bomb chicken. Don't everybody like my whatever. Maybe you ever thought about opening up a restaurant? You complain about all these Arabs pimping us, well, guess what? You can go to your state senator, alderman, state representative, and they can give you the financing for you. Tax increment financing, y'all. It's free. See, the complaints don't stop. We gonna have to stop. 2020 is perfect vision, backward and forward. You already seen what happened in the past. Let's move forward. Something else. Let's get this cracking with this other stuff we dealing with, man. Why are we arguing about nonsense? He has some great ideas. You have to have your start execution. That's the point of this show. We going to start executing. So, when you look at what's around you, like, everybody's stuck in the house right now. Most of us, I don't know what's going on. I'm assuming that most people in the country stuck in the house. Can't go to work. Y'all ass don't like y'all job, so please stop complaining about staying in the damn house. You paying this hot as giraffe coochie ass cable bill. You're paying for Netflix, Fire Sticks, and all this. Watch the damn TV. But guess what? You can be reading to your kids, setting an example. But while you are put on this home confinement, so to speak, SBA was also available. Right now it's defunded, this current administration and staff. But you know what? Every state, hey, Jungle Brother, I'm glad you said that. Every state has a budget, and in that budget, it is allocated for money to give away. We don't ask for a jungle. There has to be. Look, this is what you do, my brother. The person who told you about SBA, ask them what some alternative funding options. See, because they sitting on it. And I'm believing as some they telling they millionaire and they billionaire homies how to get that money, man. That's what I'm assuming. Because there is no wasted money in the United States of America. It's all spent. And whether it's gonna be spent in our community or somewhere else is the key. But while we sitting here, man, I'll be glad when things get back to normal. You know what was normal for our community? Police shooting at us. People selling dope in our communities, a lot of our communities. Being under attack, underfunded schools. Why the fuck you want to go back to normal? We got to create a new normal. We have to create a new normal. No more of this pissing and moaning left and right. Make people prove or get their ass out your way, or work as a collective to get it down your damn self. If how many people you know with $10,000 worth of sneakers, $10,000 worth of jeans, or hey, hell, let's keep it funky. How many people we know that's drug dealers who killing it? Hey man, let's clean up some of your money, buddy. And then you hire your drug dealer homie who financed this get down as the president of your company. It's really his. It's really his. What? That's how you keep his black ass out the penitentiary. And, hey man, I know a lot of people standing around in the streets and do their thing. Those are some of the smartest people I've ever met in my life. I mentioned this several times. I'm going to keep mentioning it. How in the hell, since 1972, they've been trying to teach the metric system in schools. But everybody who's selling dope know the metric system from the corner. I guarantee you, most of us listening didn't know there was a 1,000 grams in a kilo when they were in high school. But you got a homie who know it, who flunked out of high school. We have to use what we had to get what we want, y'all. We have to. Back to this guy at 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue. If he is reelected, what's your plan for him? We can sit back and get scared and be like, oh man, this is bullshit. Or we can come up with, we can start enacting these plans and present them to him all the time. We can continue to complain, or we can make him earn his money. We don't really have to deal with him. We can deal with the governor. We can deal with the state senator. We can deal with the U.S. senator. We can deal with the state representative or our community representative. And they have to give us this money. See, you can create your own bubble. Or you can just suffer the consequences. Because what we're doing right now is suffering the consequences. We are truly suffering the consequences for not being organized and prepared. I can tell you a million reasons why I sound like a damn fool. Watch this, y'all. You don't agree with me? Watch this. H-Rap, that ain't gonna work because brothers ain't gonna work together. H-Rap, that ain't gonna work because brothers is ignorant. H-Rap, that ain't gonna work because people sitting around getting high and drinking. H-Rap, that ain't gonna work because people ain't gonna listen to you. You see what I'm saying? I can come up with the damn reasons, but we know the reasons. Let's come up with some reasons why it will work. How about this? I'm sick and tired of doing this shit. I'm tired of stressing myself the fuck out. I'm sick of all this bullshit. The fact that the drug dealers are measuring and measures to tell you that that it's not originating from here, yet the boys come from me get arrested. Exactly. It's not coming from here. But you know what? A lot of shit don't come from here and we don't take advantage of it. See, the difference in our Crips, Bloods, Gangster Disciples, Vice Lords, or whatever neighborhood gang or street organization that you live near, the difference in them and the difference from the people who we like to call organized crime, the goddamn Cusazi family and all of them, those some gangs. The difference in us and them is they use that to obtain power in their community and then put themselves in a position to win. That's the only difference. Lil Nuck Nuck and Pookie and all them motherfuckers. All they have to do is start buying up the property, renting out homes to you, treating you like a human being, and taking advantage of. See, I always reference this every show. This book I read it 29 years ago. And the book told me everything that you see on movies and TV is to desensitize you for plans that are being enacted in the future. You will see a future in a movie. But guess what? On the wire, most people I know love The Wire. Stringer Bell and Avon was buying up property, rehabbing it, and turning themselves into millionaires. Why don't we do that? Why don't we talk to our Stringer Bell and Avon, our Marlo and those type of guys, and get them to rehab things and get that out of our community? You know, now you ain't got to stand outside with the corner boys. You can make millions legally, and you ain't got to have nobody blowing down your back. That's what we need to be doing. Focusing on that kind of thing. Because you know what, man? I refuse to call a drug dealer a horrible individual because he's selling poison to his people. But because you know why? That's a dude that took advantage of a situation that just wasn't built for him. And he made the best out of a horrible situation. Would we prefer that he sell our brothers and sisters, nieces, nephews, cousins, aunts, and uncles drugs? Hell no, we wouldn't. But when you remove art, science, vocation, and other opportunities from our community, what else is a person to do? It's bananas. It is purely bananas. I want y'all to listen to this Black History Fact, and I'll be right back.
The Harlem Hellfighters was a regiment of New York National Guardsmen in the First World War. They were set up to fail by their own government. They were humiliated, degraded, eventually given to the French army as a throwaway, and they ended up coming home as one of the most decorated units in the entire U.S. Army.
The Harlem Hellfighters are one of the most important regiments in American history. In World War I, they helped to establish to the entire world the power of Black soldiers in the military.
It was very difficult at that time for African Americans to get into the United States military because there was this perception that African Americans would not do well in battle. They had to overcome the prejudice of their own countrymen and yet also perform ably on the battlefield.
Like so many units of African American descent, when they go overseas, they're not sure what they're going to do. Are they going to fight as infantry? Or are they going to be stevedores and load ships? Or are they going to be labor units and cut wood?
And so they're committed to labor duty. They're unloading ships, building latrines, those type of support services. And as you can imagine, these men have been trained, and they're willing to fight. They're ready to fight. And this is stressful for them.
They were finally given to the French Army, which in a way was an even greater insult, because in the First World War, when the United States entered, General Pershing, the commanding officer, was very clear that American forces would not be fed piecemeal into the French and British Army, because the French and British wanted reinforcements, and Pershing said absolutely not. When Americans join this war, they will fight as an American force under an American flag led by an American general. ... Except for the Black guys. You can have them.
Henry Johnson is perhaps one of the most remarkable Black military heroes in U.S. history.
And he found himself in no man's land with Private Needham Roberts manning a listening post.
And Needham Roberts hears click, click, click. And he realizes somebody's cutting the wire. It's potentially a German raid.
And so Roberts is passing him grenades, and they line up these grenades, and the Germans actually do come across the lines. Roberts is hurt, and now Henry Johnson is left to to defend their position and to stave off this attack. And then he makes the mistake of jamming a French cartridge into his American gun, and it no longer will work. And the Germans are on top of it.
He then used his rifle like a club, and then he ended up fighting with a knife against the Kaiser's best and turned them.
He's wounded in the fray. He's struck, for example, in the foot, and has a debilitating injury as a result. And he fights them off, he says, for what seemed like an hour.
The Germans ran shrieking into the night, all because of one man.
It's not until the next morning that people realize what a tremendous act this was. They discover four bodies of dead German soldiers. And they also realize from the equipment and other things that are left behind that as many as 30 may have been involved in this altercation.
As soon as he drove off those Germans, the French awarded him with the Croix de Guerre, a great honor. Unfortunately, it took about 75 years for the U.S. government to give him the Legion of Merit. Had he been white, he would have walked out of that war with the Medal of Honor. What was so shocking to me when I began to research the story of the Hellfighters was that after they had performed so magnificently in combat, the United States government actually sent a memorandum to the French government, essentially implementing Jim Crow, essentially saying, don't give them some notion that they are equals, because we don't want them taking that notion back to the United States and demanding equality.
When he comes back to the United States, he's not awarded the Purple Heart. There's no notation in his military record of his injury. And so he winds up not being able to work because of this injury. He doesn't get any kind of assistance from the army or from the government as a result. And he ends up dying in 1929 penniless. So it again shows the paradox. Here's this great story of valor and of courage on the part of the soldier. And ultimately, he comes back to a nation that doesn't honor that sacrifice.
We tend to think we all know American history so well, but the story of the Harlem Hellfighters should be one of the first stories told. It wasn't about killing other people. It was about being Americans and serving their country well. That was the inclination of the Harlem Hellfighters.
When you are African American in 1917, democracy is armor. Democracy is a weapon. And to fight for a war to make the world safe for democracy was something more than just some ethereal crusade for the Hellfighters. It had concrete results. They were fighting for the rights to be a citizen of the country that they were born in.
Back at you, live and direct, Bill for this network. This is H-Rap B. Bill Destroy is the name of the program. Thank you for listening. The reason I played that is because, as you see, even when you try to do right here, you'll get done wrong. It's easy for people to dismiss this. That was 100 years ago, right? Things have changed. Yeah. Instead of having to be docile and get disrespected, you can be loud and get disrespected. That's what you're saying. You know what else has changed? The fact that we no longer own our own businesses, we no longer own our own homes, we no longer are literate, and we have accepted what people are willing to give us. That's what has changed this world. The reason I'm doing this show is because I want people to understand what's going on so we can galvanize the people in our community who are righteous and move in one direction so we can get our community back on track. Okay? Now, I'm glad my man and my man Jungle Brother, and me and Jungle Brother had a real bad disagreement about 6-7 months ago. And it was about voting. But here's the thing, man. This is why I'm going to admit Jungle Brother was right. If you don't elect the proper people into the offices that run your government in your city, county, state, or even in this country, you'll be subjected to the tyranny of people who don't like you. To people that hate you. Don't like is putting it mildly. To people that hate you. The reason I'm saying this is this. There are two things that happened this week and this week only that I can identify of why, identify with why you should make sure you know who the hell is running your government, local and federal. The first thing is voters' rights. Voters were put in grave danger. Well, actually, brothers and sisters were put in grave danger. Because one of the states that hasn't been hit as hard by the corona epidemic, the corona pandemic, is Wisconsin. But it is one community in Wisconsin that was hit hard. Needless to say, it was a community filled with people that look like me and you. Now, the governor of the state of Wisconsin said, hey, we're going to suspend this election thing while this pandemic is going on, because there's no way for social distancing and an electoral situation, because we all on top of each other. We lined up outside. How the hell are you going to be 6 feet away from somebody and it's 45, 50, 60,000 people trying to vote? First of all, the voting thing, the voting polling places were reduced to 3 counties, all of which where we were. Mind you, 70% of people in Wisconsin that died look like me and you in this corona pandemic. And he reinstituted it, and then they had the backup of the Supreme Court of the United States of America, I mean, of the state, back it up again. So what they did was say, it don't make a difference what y'all doing and how much danger we put y'all in. Take your ass out there and vote. They just pretty much told them, fuck. So now you got people in Wisconsin who look like me and you, who a lot of us suffer from diabetes. A lot of we are the sickle cell people. A lot of us suffer from heart disease and things of that nature, and which weakens your immune system. And now you may have a virus that'll kill you with a weak immune system, and you have to stand around all those people. This is why you have to pay attention to who you elect them, because they assign judges that will put your life in danger. I mean, excuse me, with 5 districts. Reduced to 5 districts. So now you got people congregating. You know, it's easy to stand around and say, see, the brothers in the hood don't want to go in the house. Well, guess what? The brothers in the hood traditionally don't vote. So the people who were in those 5 districts voting, those were the people like me and you. Those were not the dudes who selling cocaine, crack, or heroin, and other barbiturates and amphetamines. Those are the people who get their ass up and go to work every day. Those are the dudes who vote. So they're trying to kill you off because you didn't pay attention to who you were electing in your municipalities, and you were unable to just say, bam. The mayor of that town said, go vote. Damn what the governor said. He needs to be removed, needless to say. Now, the thing that's most disturbing is, if you're from the New York tri-state area, or you know who the former Mayor Bloomberg is, you've heard of this thing called stop and frisk. This is when a police officer can jump out of his car, pat you down, run your pockets, and do what he want to do, hold you for suspicion. Milwaukee is the largest city in Wisconsin, but only has 5 of the 166 voting booths in the whole state. Let that sink in. Thank you, John Brother. Stop and frisk. It was proven that stop and frisk was all about stopping people that look like us. Latino brothers too, but I'm not Latino. I can only be concerned. While my leg is broken, I can only be concerned about healing my leg. Once I get healthy, I can help you. But I need to help me now. It was primarily focused on brothers. So you stopping brothers, meanwhile white dudes are getting away with it. Guess what? The reason I bring up this stop and frisk thing, all you have to do is look at Kansas versus Glover. Kansas versus Glover. The United States Supreme Court said, while we're going through this pandemic, they issued an edict saying, while we're going through this pandemic, it's cool to reinstitute stop and frisk nationwide. So if you and 3 of your homeboys riding around in the car, or you and 2 of your friends riding around in the car, the police have the ability to assume that you guys are suspicious, pull you over and shut you down. Kansas versus Glow. Look it up. That's all you have to do is look it up, man. This is going on right under your nose while you worry about the pandemic, while you worry about toilet paper and other stupid shit, and trying to live and survive and not stress yourself out. As I said on the show Wednesday, one of the frequent callers on the show that I listen to by the name, her name is Karen Hunt. I listen to Joe Madison too. Man called up and said his wife stressed herself to death. Stressed herself to death, worried about what's going on in the world today. His wife died from being stressed. So, this shit is outrageous. So, this is another reason you need to control who's in these offices and stop listening to them and stop telling them. Because it's what we do is when the police shake you down, everybody love to say, man, they work for us. The mayor worked for you, too. Your damn alderman worked for you, too. Have that same energy. Have that same energy. Your man Donald Trump has put over 150 federal judges in place. That means when they ready to do whatever the hell they want to do, like incarcerate your ass for some insane amount of time, or when you got a guy who raped a woman behind a dumpster and it would ruin his life and they let him go home, these are the people who are in charge of it. Your local judge, your federal, your life is in danger. Your life is in danger. That's what I'm trying to get you to understand. And we sit around and we complain about nonsense, man. We complain about nonsense, y'all. We can no longer complain about nonsense. We are not at liberty to do that. Can't do it anymore. We have to organize. When you look at the state of Florida, everybody in Florida is trying to apply for unemployment and can't. Would you like to know why? Because this is the way it works. Your unemployment system was installed by, he's a senator, his name is Rich Scott. He was attempting to run for president and he was trying to keep his unemployment numbers down. So he revamped the website and made it more difficult for the Floridians to apply for unemployment. So now if you've been furloughed and you have to put on your paperwork, a lot of people, this may be happening throughout the country too. If you're being furloughed, they ask you a question. Are you currently looking for a job? You would have to put no and they reject you. The trick is to go back and do it again, and then a human being will see what's going on and then you'll get your benefits. But this information is not being disseminated throughout the country. So your ass is suffering, and our brothers and sisters are suffering for it, and then we just get upset. Earlier, I mentioned about medication and things for this pandemic. One of the ones that they are pushing is hydroxide chloroquine. It's a drug that helps fight malaria. The thing is, 2020 vision. Remember I said that earlier? Your past will teach you about the future. You see in the past, you can see in the future, you see in the present. Perfect. Your president was pushing this. By the way, he's a small stockholder in the company that makes it. That's for one. And this, if nothing else, this should turn you off from anything this administration pushes at you in regards to a drug. The president of the United States stood on TV and said, and I quote, what do you have to lose? I do believe he said that at damn near 4 years ago to the day. Black people, what do you have to lose? This is the dude that defunded the infectious disease program. They could have prevented it. He defunded it. What do you have to lose? Like you said, your life. No, bro, if we can't go to the polls. No. I'm not saying don't go to the polls. I'm not saying, oh, bro, if you can't go to the polls, we will have to vote through the mail. He got 450 million people to do it. They need billions. Trump is trying to stop us from going to the polls through the mail. Oh, yeah. That goes without saying. I was going to get to that in Georgia. Trump is going to the mail. He voted himself through the mail, saying if we do it, it'll be widespread fraud. Well, guess what? We need to be fraud. That was my main man, K3000. Good to see him back on the scene. No, I'm not saying don't go to vote. What I'm saying is these people, the governor of the state of Wisconsin, tried to postpone the election until this pandemic is over. And the mayor of Wisconsin said, fuck that, took it to the Supreme Court and they instituted voting again. He wasn't saying don't vote. He was saying, until this thing calms down, I'm gonna need y'all to relax. And then when it picks back up, we can vote then. I'm not saying don't vote. I was gonna get to that with the jackass in Florida, K3000. Georgia. He put Chief Rocker and the X Squad and the rest of them brothers. Okay. My bad. Y'all having a conversation. It's cool. Yeah. So, this thing with unemployment, it's stopping people from getting their benefits. It's putting people on edge. And then it helps him promote this nonsense, go back and put your life in danger. Because we will never know if this is or is not a real thing. But you know what? I ain't willing for none of y'all to take a chance at it. If you don't have to, don't do it. Don't do it, is what I'm saying. You got people all over the world that's trying to use us as guinea pigs. French doctors talk about use Africans. They don't have any intelligence. This is in France. This is why we must galvanize our communities and fight against everybody. We must. Sup, everybody, battling this health issues. But listen, get well soon, my brother RC. On the mail voting, the UPS is United Postal System is struggling financially right now, and it's going to turn into a problem if they don't do the funding soon. Hey, our brother RC, a consistent listener, he said the United States Postal Service is struggling for funding right now, and people who don't know this, look, you know how everybody's thanking the police officers? Salute. Thanking the firemen, salute. Thanking the nurses and doctors and the medical professionals, salute. The United States Postal Service workers are in an extreme amount of danger too, because they dropping off mail every day to every house in your city, state, and town. And nobody's giving a damn about them. Your boy Bernie Sanders is on Capitol Hill right now trying to get funding. But see, this is what I'm talking about. We funding things that we don't even know about. But when you put the right people in place, people like my boy Chill, my boy Dre, and other people that I know who work in the United States Postal Service, their lives are in less danger and they need the funding that they should be getting. If you could put $1 trillion into the stock market, you could put a half a billion into the postal service and get these brothers and sisters right. But see, again, these are working class people every day. These people get up and go to work for their money every day. So don't nobody give a damn about them. Don't nobody give a damn about them. And as K3000 just mentioned, this damn fool of a governor in the state of Georgia, he's encouraging, he's trying to get the schools to open back up, putting your children in check, putting these teachers in check, putting everybody in jeopardy, their futures in jeopardy. And it's more than obvious why they're doing this, because their fearless leader has built a reputation on keeping the financial situation in order. The economy is booming under Trump. First and foremost, if you know anything about political science, you understand that it takes 4 years for a president to do anything, and anything he's done, it takes about 4 years for that thing to go into action. So, while your boy been tooting his own horn and breaking his arm, patting himself on the back, talking about the financial situation in the United States of America, these are residual effects from the previous administration. Listen to what I'm saying. You notice when he got in the office, he did all these defunding these programs, like the Center of Disease Control, like the infectious disease people, like lowering these regulations and things of that nature. And that's what's biting him clean, raw, buck naked in his ass. It's biting him in his ass because, we don't need all this prevention. We don't need that. This is a waste of money. It's just bureaucracy. And now it's biting him in his ass. Because those people would have told him 6, 8, 12 months ago, you need this. All you have to do is listen to the homie Don Lemon. Go to Don Lemon on Facebook, on YouTube. Don Lemon showed a speech in 2014 of Barack Obama saying that they needed funding to prevent something like this, for airborne disease, infectious disease to hit our country. And this is why we need this. And you see your president and his cronies try to say that that never happened. Trump and his buddies want the post office to become private, which Trump will be connected with the company that controls it. It's all about the bread. Thank you, Chuck, brother. Thank you. All it is a bunch of bullshit that while you are struggling and stressed out about living, day-to-day living, these dudes are stacking paper and like the EPMD, they snapping necks and cashing large checks. But we have to be prepared. This is why we have to stop figuring out ways to lose and figure out a way to win. The most disturbing news of this week is the fact that they're telling us you need to wear masks and gloves to protect who you are and your life. That's not the disturbing part. That's being safe and sound. The most disturbing part is being a brother. I'm not a small guy. I'm not tall. I'm a wide dude. Brothers like myself, Jungle Brother, number one chief, Rocket Beatway, we not small guys. But we live in America. We live in Los Angeles, one of the most corrupt police departments in the United States of America. We live in Chicago, one of the most corrupt police departments in the United States of America. Jungle Brother and number one chief, Rocket, they live in the South. Enough said. What do you say about a big black man walking towards you with a mask on his face? Your life is in danger. So now, you damn near gotta think, do I protect myself from Corona or the Cacopolis? Listen to that, man. Do I protect myself from COVID-19 or do I protect myself from the police? Because before this shit is over, one of them dogs gonna shoot down one of our brothers and say, I didn't know. It was a brother on Cameron Hunter's show. my buddy Jungle Brother said, take him off the wide dudes. He lost 2 pounds last week. My man, I'm getting off too. But Cameron Hunter's show again, y'all. If y'all don't have serious satellite radio, all you have to do is go to YouTube. She has segments all the time. Check out Good Sister, man. Joe Madison is also a good brother to check out too. But one of the brothers who she have on the show, I can't think of his name presently, he's a 6'2", 250 pound man. He said he was 6'4", 250 pound. Well, anyway, he's a big brother. He said he went to the gas station and literally contemplated taking his mask off because he saw police. A year ago, I got pulled over by a cop and I literally said to myself, this could be it. We shouldn't be living like this, brothers and sisters. We should not be living like this. We should not be living under the fear of our lives being taken away from us because we're trying to protect ourselves, or our lives being taken away from us because we just existed in this fucking country. And if I'm offending people with the language, I understand. I apologize, but I'm passionate about my people. It's just something I just don't understand our people don't get it. But if we don't go ahead and do it, we're going to get screwed. In regards to these masks, these two young brothers got kicked out of Walmart for wearing masks. So the whole world telling you to wear masks, protect yourself, and you kick us out of Walmart. This is when we need to have this internet outrage. Like last week I said, Jesse Lee Peterson needs to feel the wrath of our internet. Diamond and Silk, who are still dismissing the deaths of our loved ones as a hoax. They need to feel the wrath of our loved ones. And this is the opportunity for us to start shopping at our own joints and tell Walmart to kick rocks and flip-flops. Now, we are not going to put a dent in this Walmart thing because everybody loves Walmart. But I got two things to tell you. Walmart has yet to come out and make a statement that I've heard about the disrespect of our brothers. Even though it was a police officer, you still should have spoke out against it. Two, Walmart is anti-union. And when you defunct these unions, you get people to pay whatever the hell they want to pay. This is why we need to reestablish our communities, build up our communities, create an infrastructure in our communities to be what we want them to be versus what we wish these other people would do for us. At this point, I want to offer y'all some information, some more information. Instead of arguing and fighting and saying what we are going to do, again, I need us to organize. One thing that disturbed the hell out of me in Baltimore City, Baltimore, Maryland, was a housing complex, or they call it housing projects, housing complex, low-income housing complex. You have a city police officer, an employee of the city of Baltimore, walking through the housing complex, coughing on brothers and sisters, saying it ain't nothing because remember, y'all not affected by the COVID-19 virus. You hear me? Coughing on people. Now, a lot of people would hear that, man, they should have whooped his ass. And be honest with you, maybe not the people who got coughed on, but it should have been some other dudes kicking that dude ass. But the people who got coughed on or who are in video, what you need to be doing is filing a civil lawsuit for one, get that dude tested. If he tests positive for COVID-19, sue the state of Maryland and the city of Baltimore for attempt murder. He needs to be arrested for attempt murder because it's been on the television and it's been nationwide that this pandemic affects our community more than it affects any other community in America. So if you are brazen enough to walk up on me and cough on me, you should go to jail. Because if this thing is affecting me more than it affects anybody in America, and you cough in my face, you in essence said, I'm trying to kill you. That is a terrorist threat. That is attempt murder. He needs to be terminated. And you need to sue the city. You need to sue the police officer's pension. And you need to do away with this type of behavior. But what has happened is this. Due to the propaganda that has been spread out through the United States of America, we have been undervalued. Our life don't mean anything because you can find a brother or sister just about anywhere in the country that'll tell you, brothers is this and brothers is that, sisters is this and sisters is that. We can find that anywhere you want. You can go just about anywhere in the country, any place in the country, and you can get somebody to say something bad about our community. That's in our community. So we undervalued. Our lives aren't as important because all they show on TV and on radio is the bad things that happen in our community. Why have you never seen? This is D. Gray from X Squad, and he going to work busting his ass on the news. No, this is Jungle Brother from Real Cash Radio. He busting his ass in the community. This leads to Duke from being a chicken. No, I'm just messing. That's a little inside joke with me and Lisa. But this is Lisa Duke. She busting her ass. This is RC. But you never see that. But you see, this is H-Rap. He shot four people today. This is H-Rap. He robbed a gas station. This is H-Rap. He pulled another welfare scam. So with the value, we are underestimating, because what we do is underestimate ourselves. Substandard education is substandard education. Let's not, it is a serious thing. But what I want you to do is understand this. Dr. King was raised on substance education. Medgar Evers was raised on substance education. And he has a PhD, and Medgar Evers is an attorney, was an attorney. There are millions upon millions of us that were raised on substance, our grandparents, our grandfathers, our grandmothers. Some of our people can't even read and became millionaires. So, whereas what we have to do is allocate the funds to educate our children from our own pockets. Oh, you're not going to educate my child at school? That's cool. Hey, yo, Tyrone, you ain't getting no Xbox this year, homie. You finna get a damn iPad. You can learn some of these education things. Nah, no more True Religion jeans or whatever them expensive. Whatever expensive items you buy your children, refrain from that and put educational tools in their pockets. You know, we walk around with computers, and to quote Chuck D, it's either going to be a toy or a tool. That is not a phone. That's a computer. Everything that you can do on a computer, you can do on your cell phone. So as Chuck D said, it's either going to be a tool or a toy. Kids got their face buried in the phone all day. Okay, be on the phone, but I'm going to need you to do this application right here. And if it's not done within the next hour, taking your phone. See, if we start doing those kinds of things, we will create an environment in which our children understand that, hey, either I learn or I die. Learning can be fun, but what you have to do is put your child in a position to learn something he wants to. Yeah, he needs to know history. He needs to know mathematics. He needs to be a proficient and efficient reader. But give him something he wants to know. Oh, you love Dr. Dre? Okay, well, let me teach you something about music and music history. Let me introduce you to Branford Marsalis. Let me teach you about this guy. Let me teach you about this guy. Oh, you like to argue? Let me introduce you to attorney Billy Martin, attorney Johnny Cochran, and others. Let me introduce you to these guys. Let me teach you about Medgar Evers. You have a vivid imagination. Let me teach you about this guy named James Baldwin. Let me teach you about Maya Angelou. Let me teach you about these people. Because these people are the people that inspired your parents, inspired you, inspired millions around the world. So they need to inspire your child too. If you are a bombastic in your face guy, damn Stephen A. Smith, introduce your child to James Baldwin. If you look at the way James Baldwin is talking about white folks in America in the 50s and the 60s, he will blow your mind. Oh, by the way, not only is James Baldwin a brother doing this, he a gay brother doing this. So they double hated his ass. But I'm telling y'all, man, these are the people we need to be introducing our children to. You know, there's somebody, introduce your kids to Granville Woods, who made the walkie-talkie, which is the grandfather of the cell phone. Something simple as the dude who invented the Super Soaker is a brother. The internet, a brother. You got a kid who always lying, he has a vast imagination. It was a sister who wrote Terminator and The Matrix. This is how you put your children in positions to win. You ever notice how affluent people put their kids in music programs? When you grow up in affluence, you know how to play an instrument. It's a reason, because it helps spurn the creativity of an individual. It's a relaxing feature. And it's a creative part of your brain that is open wide. You know, I want to say rest in peace to Earl Gilbert Gray Sr. Y'all don't know who Earl Gilbert Gray Sr. is. Somebody else you need to introduce your children to. He's the brother who published the Black Enterprise magazine. See, we got a lot of these young brothers. Hey, do yourself a favor. We got a lot of young brothers out here acting a fool. Get their ass a Black Enterprise magazine. One of them drug dealers on your block. It'll blow his mind. Hey man, this for you. See, we can't discard these young people. We have to uplift and help. You know, we have to. Thank you, Jungle Brother. We have to take the necessary steps to continue to develop our communities a little bit by little bit. Create, as I said, create community organizations. Create blocks for a president. Involving your kids with the process. Communicating with people on other blocks around you. North, south, east, and west. Create forcing these political people to do your bidding. You can no longer complain if you're not trying to fight for what you need. No more. We're not doing that anymore, man. No more complaining. Unless your plan fails you. And then when your plan fails you, you get on the phone with Jungle Brother, you get on the phone with Rap, you get on the phone with RC, you get on the phone with Rocker, you get on the phone with Knox, and have all of their people complain to their people. See, we don't have to have money to complain, but we gotta stop. It does me no good to get on the phone, hey, be great, man. We ain't got no garbage cans in my neighborhood. That school program is not being funded properly. Like this. I told my sister Loki, y'all know she in the chat room. I told my sister Loki this week. If y'all don't know, Loki feeds people out of her pocket bi-weekly. Y'all hear that? Out of her pocket bi-weekly. Okay, and I'm checking out my sister Karen Hunter. Karen Hunter got this white lady on our show who created a program called Gooder. Y'all heard me right, Gooder. And I just put her website in the chat room. GOODR.CO. She took advantage of Bill Clinton old pre-pass. He had a Good Samaritan bill pass. Meaning, if you own a restaurant and you give away food out the kindness of your heart, you can't be sued by somebody for getting sick from that food. So she piles up this food and gives it to the homeless. And then she starts feeding families. And when she started feeding families, she realized there was a great need out there. And guess who are her top funders? Rappers and athletes. She named, to be specific, the Baby, Future, and what's the boys of the Migos. She named them specifically. So I got on the phone with Sister Low-Key. Low-Key taking steps so she can get some of that same funding. I mentioned this on the last show as well. These are things that we can take advantage of. If you tired of things in your community, create a 501c3, a nonprofit organization to do whatever you want done. And then you have your people, after you organize it, you had a damn politician give you the funding to start it. And then you have that same politician reach, like in Chicago, I'm going to have him reach out to the people over at the United Center, Zach Levine, Kobe White, and all y'all. I'm going to need some of that bread about y'all so I can feed or entertain, I can occupy my young people's free time or help my seniors. I want to make a challenge to everybody listening. Since we talk of community, Everybody knows somebody old and making money. Ring their bell, go out to the lawn, and ask them, can you help me? Can I do something for you? Do you need your garbage taken out? Put it on your back porch, I'll take your garbage to the alley. Or something of that nature. Do you need to go to the store? Leave a list or something. I'm such and such. I will bring you the stuff and then you give me the money when I get back. Old people don't play the type of games, most of them. Yeah, you, oh man, what's the old person? Yeah. Let's not worry about the one crooked ass old lady. For the most part, seniors don't get over on people. Help them out, man. Oh, by the way, your son, your daughter, your niece, your nephew, your grandchild will see you helping people. And they will want to help as well. We have to. This is not an option. How about this? Since we're talking about creating a block club and a community uplifting thing, if it's 30 houses on each side of your block, you know, 30 houses on one side, 30 houses on the other side, let's just say 20 to be safe. If you have those people give you, if you have everybody on that block give up $20, you could pay some kids, $20, $600 every 2 weeks to cut all your grass. Guess what you've just done? You've eliminated one drug dealer. Hell, maybe some of us want to do that shit for $600 a week. You can go to the I just got a text message from a good brother. SBA.gov, Small Business Administration. So you can get the help that you need to develop. That was from the brother D-Grade. I ain't gonna just say from a good brother. My main man, D-Grade, just sent me that. I got to give him credit. We got to start giving people credit for what they're doing. Use these organizations to get you out of the bad situation that you're in. Man. Use your friends and family. Look, check this out. This was funny. This was funny about this get down. We have had arguments and disagreements and fights with people here on Spring. I don't like him no more. I ain't supporting his show no more. So use that same energy. Hey, I don't like homie, but he do know this and work with each other. Use that same shit, man. Last, and something I believe is extremely important, because we caring about each other again and we working with each other again at my request, please and thank you in advance. I want y'all to do this. I want y'all to do this, man. Don't just think about yourself. Think about the seniors in your community. Think about our sisters who walk in to and fro. The single moms who are out in these streets late at night and things of that nature. Let's think about some of the people who have not made the best decisions. Do y'all understand what's going on with our brothers and sisters that are incarcerated? We don't usually pay attention to them unless we got somebody who's close to us in one of those bad situations. But think about this. If our community is under attack by this COVID-19, we are being savagely destroyed week by week by this COVID-19. Whether it's real or not, some people are dying. So for the people who are going, well, please don't introduce me to that non-empirical information if you cannot back it up. In other words, stop talking out your ass if you can't prove it. Now, these people who are just like me and you, suffering from diabetes, high blood pressure, sickle cell, and other, those people are in behind those walls. It was a real nice treat to let people out early because they didn't want to affect them with the COVID-19 virus. Thank you, Thank you. As they used to say back in the 70s, that was mighty white of you. With that being said, I want y'all to look at it like this. Our brothers and sisters in there, their lives are literally in danger. Their lives are literally in danger. Because there's no way in hell you can social distance with in a 6x10 cell. And this is the part that really bothers me. Why these people, do you understand that a person who's incarcerated has lost all his ability to defend himself? And what I mean by defend themselves is this. When you are incarcerated, you can't vote. You don't have no rights. You are officially a crash test dummy. So they are going to be using these people to test some of these drugs on. If they already not using them. Think about that, man. It's a dude in prison right now who could be used as a crash test dummy for this to fight a fucking disease, and they don't even have a choice to say no. I don't want to be a part of that. That could be your brother, your uncle. That could be anyway. You know. That could be anybody. Do you really want your aunt, uncle, cousin, brother, or what have you subjected to something like that? That is the greatest insult to humanity in the world. I'm going to, because you made a mistake, made a bad decision, or what have you, I'm going to take your life from, I'm going to take your life and use you as a guinea pig to potentially save others' lives. And you can't sue me. And I'm, hey, better yet, damn, sue you. You don't even know if I did it. Because I can lie to you, present this as something that's going to protect you. And because I am officially a slave, according to the 14th Amendment, you cannot be a slave unless you break the law. And I can just use you how I see fit. So, again, this is another reason to vote. This is another reason to take care of your family. This is another reason we need to come together. Because just because my brother, uncle, sister, aunt, grandparent, father, mother, or friend decided that he wanted to participate in the terrorist activities does not give you the right to incarcerate them and use them as fucking lab rats. That's what's going on with our brothers and sisters, man. This is why, and recapping the show from people who came in at the end of the middle, I need people to start practicing civics. Know the people on one side of your street, from corner to corner, and the other side of your street from corner to corner. Create a block club. Create a president of block club. Encourage your people on the next block to do the same. Do it for everybody, one block, three blocks to your left, to your corner to the left, three blocks to the corner to your right. Everybody who's under your alderman or state representative, we need to start getting to know them. So we can protest via email, via what have you. Do whatever it takes to get street lights put on your in your community. Trash receptacles put on your corners. After school programs instituted. Better academic situations. The reopening of schools and things of that nature. We have to get it done. And then we go to our state senators and state representatives and aldermen and city councilmen and get money from their asses to get to grants, not loans, grants. So you can start your own business. This is what we need to do. And as we continue to pick up speed and momentum, what we'll do is have a community that can just prepare to fight nationwide. Because if somebody hurts one of the sisters in the chat room, she can come to here. She can reach out to somebody who has their own network, New Match Radio, the Real Cash Rangers, XY Radio, MCDE, and Bifidus Network. Say, I need 15 minutes to say what happened to me, my cousin, uncle, nephew, niece, little brother, friend, or what have you. And then we can get together and start a campaign to stop these kinds of things. Wrongfully incarcerated, wrongfully prosecuted, things of that nature. We have to. The present is now. There is no such thing as the future. Every second you enter the future. So we have to live in the now and get things done now. With that being said, y'all, thank y'all for the support for Built for This Network. I have two additional things from on the Black History side. It's only going to take y'all 8 minutes to listen to. This lady is going to display exactly how I feel. You don't have to agree with how I feel, but trust me, this lady is going to tell y'all how I feel. She's from one of my favorite countries in Africa. She's from Ghana. She's going to drop some science on y'all. And then you hear the elder Dick Gregory, one of the greatest brothers that ever walked the face of the earth, philanthropic, and he's a pure genius. And then you hear the lineup for our network. If you have anything to promote, if you have anything to say, reach out to your boy at HRAP_B on Instagram and on Twitter. Find me on Facebook if you want to send me an inbox or what have you, at Brian D. Williams. Yeah, HRAP B is my pseudonym. That's a nickname, whatever. I'm not scared to stand behind everything I said in the face of anybody who got a problem. Brian D. Williams, Sr. So I want y'all to listen to this, man. Continue to support the network. If you haven't hit the follow button, tell a friend to tune in. I'll be back next week, y'all, dropping some more information on how to improve our communities, information to make us a better community of Black people, and get us back on track. I'm going to say this for the last time. We are not inherently violent. We are not lazy. We are not shiftless. We are not anything that's negative. We are no different than anybody else that walks the face of the earth. We have some good seeds. We have some bad seeds. But by and large, we are an awesome group of people. We can accomplish anything that we set our minds to. Much love to everybody who tuned in. Please continue to listen. I see y'all. Y'all can check out Number One Chief Rocker Monday. Oh, well, you know, the announcement come up right after this. Two fingers, one word. It's your man, HRAP. I'm out.
Since we met you people 500 years ago, look at us. We've given everything. You are still taking. It's true. I mean, where would the whole Western world be without Africa? Our cocoa, our timber, our gold, our diamonds, our platinum, our whatever. Everything you are is us. I am not saying it, it's a fact. And in return for all of this, what have we got? Nothing. Anti-personnel indoctrination against ourselves. If you go and cook your horrible diseases like AIDS, you say it is us. You brought us tuberculosis. We didn't have this big cough until white people came here. In exchange for Africa giving Europe 500 solid years of our people, I mean, not Europe, the Western world, of our human beings to work your canes, to dig your gold, to taking gold itself, diamond, I mean, you know, fish, peanuts, palm oil, everything. In exchange for that, we have got nothing. Nothing. And you know it. Nothing. And you look upon, you know, white folks look upon us like monkeys. It is true. It's in your literature. Hey, you know, some of your best thinkers have said this about us. Have you heard of the, I mean, all these Germans? Have you heard?
Okay.
Yes. They said, Lord Burton, yes. People like that, they said, we don't even have the brain of animals. That's what we've got from you people.
But don't you think that this is over now?
Over where? Is it over? Who said that AIDS came from the green monkey?
And don't make the mistake that most of your mothers and fathers made. When I wake up in the morning, my prayer is not thank God I woke up. The Ku Klux Klan woke up this morning. The drug pushers woke up this morning. I thank God that I made another 24 hours in the most vicious, nasty, hateful, insane nation that's ever existed, with my wits, without hating, without being bitter, without being mean. And I thank God that I survived 24 hours in that type of atmosphere, with the type of amusement and friendliness. And so I would say to young folks, don't be in a state of denial of the racism and sexism. But don't let that block you. Don't teach your children that you have to be twice as good as a white. That's an awful thing to teach your child. Mm-hmm. That's like saying because you're black, white America has a right to change your dollar for 94 cents. But we used to get 50 cents, and before that we used to get nothing. Young folks have to say, we don't want more change for a dollar. Excuse me, we want a full dollar's change for a dollar, or this cash register will never ring again.
Yes.
I would also like for young blacks to understand that about 83% of all employment happened with small businesses. And excuse me, if you don't have a small business, then you have nobody to work for you. And I would say to young blacks, get into entrepreneurship. We will never catch up with white America till we get into business, because there's a thing called tax write-offs. And if you have a job and come together, 10 of you, and open up a corporation and have somebody run it, you hire somebody to run it, but you have tax write-offs. 98% of people that fly first class on airplanes would not be there if that wasn't a write-off. And yet, on that first class, they gave away last year $800 million, almost $1 billion of free whiskey. But if a welfare mother asked for some apple juice for the baby, mm-hmm. she's laughed at. Mm-hmm. And so I would say entrepreneurship, and then understand that we will never survive as a group until we get into communities and not neighborhoods. Mm-hmm. A community is, I control the police, the banks, the schools, the firefighters, and I control the floor of the money. And I have no problem when I go in a Jewish neighborhood and the shop owners are Jewish, and I go into an Italian neighborhood and the shop owners are Italian. I have a problem when I come in a black neighborhood and the shop owners is not me. A Korean has a right to come in and buy my shop for $30 million more than it's worth. That's good business. But if we decide that we're not going to do business with that one, then he'll have to sell it back, or she'll sell it back to a black person for $1 million. Yes. And then the money circulates, and that's how you change. We've been so busy dealing with the hurt and the pain and the misery and glamorizing a hand few that have made it, that we have never really looked at, like they say, your role model. If you haven't got a role model in your house, you should fall on your knees and pray to God, because something is wrong.
Yes.
And so I would say to young folks, it's not about alcohol, but it's hard for me to say that to you when a five-year-old got to reach past mama's beer and papa's wine to get some mayonnaise. I would also say to young folks that the number one drug that will wipe you out is not cocaine, it's not heroin, it's marijuana. And they deliberately make that a recreation drug, but it stays in the muscles, it stays in the blood, and it will wipe out your memory bank. And also, this is the first time in the history of TB that TB has always been known as poor folks. It's the first time that TB is not running rampant in the ghetto. It's running rampant in middle-income white America, because it's the marijuana that they spray, and that's no accident. And so I would just say to young folks, you have to reevaluate everything you've been taught. I would say to the black folks that just because a black person is 90 years old don't mean they have wisdom, and you need to listen to them, because if you was dumb and stupid when you was 9, you're dumb and stupid when you 90.
It's that Mad Knox music.
Be all the build for this network for the strong, not the weak. And this is our weekly lineup. On Mondays, number one chief rapper, Jersey Burn, brings you that recap entertainment show. On Tuesdays, the attack is on hip hop throwback with the crown holder, DJ Mad Knox. Followed by the end of the big show with Chi-Town's finest, H-Rap B. On Wednesday, the brothers gonna work it out. I'm talking about the brothers of the number one chief rapper, Jersey Burn, and H-Rap B. On Thursday, the Theory of the Culture show, Straight Talk No Chaser, with Chiz Roundtree and DJ Mad Knox. Followed by the Two-Step King, Jersey's finest, DJ Meet Dean. Opens up his groove house. And on Friday, the crown holder, DJ Mad Knox, gets your weekends right and built for this Friday mix.
Network for the strong, not the weak.
You understand what it is?